Building for the web is pretty great these days thanks to the many open source component libraries. I mean, look at these three example navigations. They look beautiful, but these animations very often come with a very hefty JavaScript dependency. Let me show you in this video how you can achieve a similar effect with modern web technology and a little bit of CSS. I built this in Figma, turned the design to code using Builder, and then copied the generated code over to CodePen. I cleaned up the CSS a little bit and added this fancy gradient here, but generally we now have a similar component that toggles an active class on these elements. The HTML is pretty basic, so we only have a main and nav element and a few links, some boilerplate CSS, and here we have some JavaScript that adds event listeners to all links to then remove first of all the active class and then add it to the currently clicked element. But let's add some animation eye candy to this active state using the fairly new View Transitions API. View transitions are probably the biggest update the web has seen in many, many years, and they allow us to transition, animate, and even morph elements into each other. They're currently supported in Chromium and Edge and the latest Safari, but you can easily ship them for the supporting browsers. So let's bring in some eye candy, use this start view transition function, and head over back to CodePen. And here in our click handler, we can first of all check if this new function here, document start view transition, is available. And if it's not, we will do the same things as we did before, just updating the DOM. This is for the unsupporting browsers, meaning Firefox. For the browsers that do support view transitions, we can now go in and we can call document start view transition, pass in a callback function, and then update the DOM inside of this callback here. And when we now check our preview, look at this. We already have a slight crossfade going on. So what's happening? When we open the dev tools and check the animations debugger, which you can open with Command Shift P and look for animations, we see that there are a lot of animations happening when we toggle the active class. Whenever we call start view transition from within JavaScript, Chrome will add all these pseudo elements here to the DOM. View transition old in this case is a screenshot of the old DOM state that was present before we called start view transition. And then we have view transition new, which is a live snapshot of the DOM after we modified it. By default, Chrome will take the root element and perform a crossfade between these two pseudo elements. And the cool thing now is that we can go into our CSS and we can add our own view transition layers. Here in our demo layer, we can now target or select the active link element and we can specify the view transition name CSS property. And now check this out. By defining a single CSS property, we can now click around and we already have a morph or transition between the active link element, which are two completely different DOM elements going on here in our preview. We can now inspect and debug the animations again. So let's see what's happening. So we can click around and here we have this new view transition going on. So we can move this slider here. So we see that's happening. It's not quite right yet, but when we inspect the DOM, there is now a new view transition layer. This new view transition group is now transitioning the positioning, the height and width of the included elements. And here we have the old screenshot and the new snapshot of our active link element. But when we now inspect this transition here, we see that Chrome is not doing it quite right because the home active link has a different aspect ratio than the project's active link. So this isn't looking pretty good. Let's fix this. In this case, we don't care too much about the width of the transitioning elements, but rather they should have the same height. And we can apply the same height to these two view transition elements, so view transition old and view transition new, by targeting them right here in CSS, and we can tell Chrome, hey, please have these two elements with the same height. So let's see how it looks now. So let's press play here, and now we see that this is already looking pretty fancy. It's not the effect that we're after, but for a few lines of CSS, I think this is pretty cool. So we have now this active nav view transition that is going on, and thanks to the root transitioning too, it looks like that these links that are not active are fading out and are going below this active element. Pretty sweet. But let's move on and let's make this background here slide under these text fragments. And to do that, I tweaked the base CSS beforehand and made sure that this background here isn't coming from the link itself, but rather its own pseudo element. So we have here the background gradient sitting on the before pseudo element. And now guess what? Thanks to the gradient being on the before, we can go into our view transition here below, and we can say that we want to target the before instead of the entire link. So let's see how it looks now. This isn't too bad, but still not quite right yet. Now the pseudo element is in its own view transition layer, and the home project's about text are on the root element. And this is why, while the view transitioning is happening, it's kind of above everything else. It's above the root transition layer. And to fix this stacking issue, we can move the links into their own view transition layer. Now we could target the links via CSS and nth child, but for these scenarios, I prefer inline styles because usually you have a templating engine in place, which means that you can guarantee that all the elements that you want to have on their own layer have a proper view transition name CSS property. Let's check the result. Well, this is a bit better, but we still have some transition issues going on here. Depending on the DOM state, when we start the view transition, sometimes our view transition for the background pseudo element is on top of these view transitions for these anchor elements. So we have to define a Z index for the view transition layers of the links. And now we're entering the cutting edge of CSS today. To apply a Z index to our link elements, we need to target their view transition layers. And we can do that in a similar way. We can take the group that is surrounding the old screenshot and the snapshot and give it a Z index. So let's see if this works. This looks pretty good to me, but now we have a similar problem that we try to avoid using the inline styles. Whenever we now add a new navigation entry to this component here, we have to touch the CSS. And this isn't great. And theoretically, there's a solution to this problem. When we go to Can I Use, we can look for View Transition class. Here we go. But the browser support of View Transition class is pretty cutting edge, I would say, 18.2 for Safari. So I'm not sure if I would use this in production already. But let's bring it still in. With the View Transition class property, we can target multiple View Transition layers. So we could go here now and target our links, and we can say that we want to have a View Transition class of nav item. And this then allows us to remove these and replace them with a single View Transition group selector. So we're selecting here all View Transition layers with the class nav item, and we define the Z index of 1. Let's see if that works. This looks pretty good to me. But again, make sure to check your browser visitor stats to see if you can use View Transition class already, or if you should target your View Transition layers like this. There's one more thing that I want to add. I think this animation already looks pretty great, but I think it could be a little bit more cute or playful. So let's select the View Transition layer for our background pseudo element here and start tweaking the ongoing animation. For example, we could now change the timing of our animation by defining animation duration and let's say 2 seconds. When we now click around, we see that it is way slower, but it shows that we can control the view transitions using good old CSS. But let's not keep it that slow, but rather define a custom animation timing function to make it like bounce a little bit. The animation timing function defines how an animation will progress. So usually you have there ease in, ease out, these kind of things, but I already defined a custom property called bounce. So where do we get this one from? To make CSS transitions and animation bounce, we can use a fairly new tool called the easing wizard. And this tool provides all sorts of different animation and transition properties, but you see here that there's also a bounce section that allows us to define subtle bouncing effects coming from CSS. So let's go with this one here. Now we can scroll down. Here we have the CSS. All right, let's get this one. We can go back into our code pen. Let's go into the root element and define our bounce custom property with this linear easing function here. Let's see if it works. It does not. Let's double check. Animation time. Let me just fix this typo here. Let's see what we got now. And this looks indeed very cute. And with that, we implemented a visual effect and animation that you would usually need a heavy JavaScript animation library for with a little bit of CSS and by calling the document start view transition function. And I don't know about you, but this is super duper exciting. If you want to copy some source code or want to see this example in action, you will find everything on the builder blog. And as always, if you have any comments or questions, drop them below. And I will see you in the next video when we build beautiful UI with modern CSS and web technologies.